All right, Alexander, let's talk about this interesting story. And I'm on RT's website, and it has to do with Belarus and a coup attempt that backfired, that was thwarted by Minsk and Moscow intel. And the title of RT's article, which describes what happened, is called US-backed coup plot involving assassination of Belarusian president, other officials foiled by Minsk and Moscow. Alexander, what do you make of this news? And what do you make of with regards to the timing of this revelation, given what we have going on in Ukraine between Russia and Ukraine and the East Ukraine and the United States as well, and this recent row between the US, NATO, EU, and Russia with regards to Ukraine. All of this is kind of bubbling up at the same time, and it may not be a coincidence. What do you make of all this stuff?
Well, can I first of all begin by saying that when I first heard about this story, I thought it was just Lukashenko coming up with, more stories about plots against him. He does this regularly from time to time. And, he was talking about there was a plot to assassinate him and that the US was involved and that there were plans for a coup. And I didn't take it very seriously at the start. And then we got more information, and it's now, I think, becoming increasingly difficult to discount the story in that way. Firstly, the Russians backed it, and they didn't just back the story. They seem to have been involved in exposing the fact that something did, or at least was being attempted in Belarus, in Minsk. Then we started to get tape recordings that the Russians were producing of conversations between people who were participants in the coup. They were apparently lured to Moscow on the basis that they would meet Belarusian, dissident Belarusian generals there. And the whole thing was a setup by Russian intelligence, and they were arrested. But there were tape recordings in which they talk about the coup, and they talk about it in great detail. And they do it in a way that rather suggests that this was a real plot. And then other people who were apparently involved in this plot, who have been identified, have come along and who are not in Belarus or in Russia, have come along, and in a kind of odd way, they've sort of corroborated this story. They've basically said that it was all, not intended seriously, but that these conversations did actually take place and that there were discussions of this nature actually going on. So I think it is now looking increasingly as if some sort of plot was being hatched. The Russians got wind of it. They tipped off the Belarusians. They carried out this entrapment in Moscow, which ended up in some members of this plot being caught. And of course, one effect of all of this is that it's going to make Belarus's relationship with the US and the West even worse. And it's going to pull Belarus even further towards Moscow. But what I must say did make me wonder increasingly about this is the timing. Because this plot was apparently intended to be hatched at the beginning of May. Now, the beginning of May seems to have been a time when all sorts of other things were supposed to happen. The US warships we've been hearing so much about were supposed to be arriving in the Black Sea around that time and patrolling the Black Sea at around that time. The British warships, which are now steaming towards the Black Sea, they also were supposed to arrive in the Black Sea at around that time. So you would have had four NATO warships from, important NATO powers, well, the United States and Britain. There would have been two carrier groups in the Eastern Mediterranean to provide support. There was, of course, all this enormous deployment of Ukrainian forces to Eastern Ukraine, and there were some rumors that, in fact, the Ukrainian offensive, if it had come, would have been launched at around that time. And of course, we have the sanctions announcement, which also seems to have been timed for around this sort of same time period, late April, early May. And on top of that, there was this meeting with between Zelensky and Erdogan in Ankara, in which the Turks said that they would accelerate arms deliveries to Ukraine. We know they've already provided drones there. There's reports the Turkish military specialists, advisors have arrived in Ukraine also. So, you know, it may all be that this is chance, but it does look as if all sorts of things, interesting things, were timed to happen at around the same time. A coup in Belarus, an offensive perhaps, a military offensive in eastern Ukraine, a warship deployment by the US and Britain to the Black Sea, a sanctions announcement, all of this happening Navalny. At the same time. By the way, a protest. There's supposed to be a protest being prepared to support Navalny, which is timed to take place on Wednesday. So it sort of rather looks as if somebody was moving a lot of pieces at the same time, except, of course, it's all unraveled because that offensive in eastern Ukraine is now looking increasingly unlikely it's ever going to happen because the Russians countered it by all those big troop movements. The US Navy is pulled back from the Black Sea. And of course, the coup in Belarus seems to have been nipped in the bud before it ever took place. So it seems to me as if there was a big play, but it seems to me as if it's all fallen apart at the last moment. And I've done a program on my channel showing how even the sanctions announcement that was being talked about in the end didn't amount to very much. It's actually less than it seemed, even less than it was when, we previously discussed it. And one wonders again whether what caused that to happen was that there were some countervailing pressures, perhaps from the Russians, which caused people to pull back in some way. So it looks as if, there is some speculation, obviously, on my part here, but it seems to me as if a lot of moves were in play directly after Biden-Harris came to, became the administration, but that they've all miscarried. I would add, by the way, there have been some really interesting articles by people like Robert Kagan, the neocon, and Victoria Nuland, who's his wife, who's now once more part of the administration, which also seem to highlight, the need for the US to take a sort of forward steps around various things. So I do wonder, but going back to the Belarus affair, as I said, there does seem to be it does seem as if something real did actually take place, or at least was being prepared. I have to say, it sounds like an Inspector Clouseau type coup. It was clearly not being prepared properly, and news of it clearly leaked, and the Russians clearly found out about it, and as I said, moved rapidly to nip it in the bud. I suspect that the Russians, by the way, have been following the situation very closely, and have been preparing ever since it looked as became clear that there was a strong chance that the Biden-Harris administration would indeed become the administration in Washington. You remember we talked way back in the autumn about, the Russians being under pressure if there was a change in the administration, and about Russia being prepared, taking steps to prepare for that. Well, it seems to me that they have done. It looks like they game planned for a lot of this and were ready.
Yeah, well, I would also say that Russia has probably learned a lot since the Maidan coup, because I do think that Maidan coup, which was one of many coups that happened in Ukraine, many protests that have happened in Ukraine over the past, say, 20 years, it did kind of catch Russia a bit sleeping at the wheel a bit. So
absolutely,
I think they probably have learned a lot of lessons from that event.
Absolutely. I would say that they were sleeping at the wheel a lot. They didn't expect it and they didn't prepare for it. And this time round, it's been completely different. I mean, the Russians have become much more assertive in their foreign policy. I mean, back in 2014, they were going out of their way to try to keep bridges open to the West. I think they felt much weaker at that time. They didn't have China. They didn't have the relationship with China worked out to the extent that they have now. Their economy was far more exposed to financial pressure from the West than it is today. And their military was in a much weaker state than it is nowadays. So I don't think they were ready. I don't think they prepared themselves for events in Ukraine. And I don't think they were ready to respond to them as then as they are now. This time, they are being much more assertive. I mean, their counter-sanctions, again, I did a program about this, are much stronger than I think people realise, because it looks like they're going to go finally and fully against the various NGOs in Russia that have been causing them so much trouble, and they're going to close them down. I mean, that's what they're saying. And it looks to me as if this time the Russians are saying enough is enough. We're going to act and act decisively to protect our interests in our on our along our western border. And they've acted in ways that this time the US, or at least not the US, but the sort of neocon element within the US, hadn't really bargained for or anticipated. And so everything that was perhaps being prepared has unraveled, and unraveled very fast. I mean, there's still likely to be some kind of a protest, I suspect, on Wednesday, but I'm going to make a prediction that's not going to make much of a difference. Note that that protest seems to be timed for the same day as Putin's State of the Nation speech. So all of this is now happening
at the same time
in all kinds of different ways. Yeah, absolutely, the Navalny protest. Yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely, yes.
This was... It seems to me like this was clear. Go ahead.
You know, I mean, it was clearly, I mean, the Navalny protest was clearly intended to take the shine off the ball of Putin's State of the Nation address and divert attention away from it. But I suspect, again, the Russians are going to be prepared for that in advance, and they're going to act much more firmly than they had previously. But carry on.
Okay, so there's no doubt that Russia has now become the singular foreign policy focus of the Biden White House. You know, I would say if the Biden White House's foreign policy pie was 100%, Russia is like 95% of that at this point in time. I mean, it's absolutely ridiculous. Maybe 2.5% Iran, 2.5% China. But everyone is focused on Russia in the Biden White House. Listening to you, it looks like they were planning some sort of shock and awe type of scenario in order to destabilize Russia, perhaps remove Putin, lead to a protest against Putin, perhaps a coup against Putin, some type of event that would just shock the country to the point where leadership just crumbled inside Russia. You know, coup in Minsk, Navalny, Ukraine, sanctions, throw in Nord Stream 2 stuff, probably. I don't know, just everything. It looked like it was this shock and awe. And my question is, do you think the neocons have some sort of intel inside of Russia that is telling them, given let me choose my words carefully, the restrictions and the COVID, and given all these things that have taken place in the last year, and perhaps economic difficulties, which, you know, is common around the world with every country now, given the state of things that we're living with. Do you think they had some sort of intel that told them, you know what, guys, now is the time. Now is the time that Putin is at his weakest. Now is the time that the government is not polling well, perhaps. I don't know if they're polling well or not. I'm just saying, now is the time that people on the street are restless. If we're going to do a shock and awe and finally be rid of this Kremlin government, now's the time. Let's do it. Do you think that they had some sort of
I think that's exactly
inside information or something that led them to believe that, so that they could move forward with all of these things.
I think they did. I think one of the problems is that they always listen to the wrong people in Russia. I think there are people in Russia who tell them those things. I don't think they're well-connected people, but I think they are. But you see, it's interesting that you mentioned all of that, because, of course, one of the things that the Russians did, and it's interesting, actually, that they did do it, was that they'd largely lifted all the restrictions in the autumn. That was a surprise, because that was not what they did in the spring. And Putin's popularity and the government's popularity have actually been growing. And the economy did less, you know, it contracted significantly less than people expected. And most people expect that when he makes his address to the nation on Wednesday, Putin will actually chart a way forward. So, I mean, you know, it didn't work out. I mean, you know, I think they do have what they think is intel, but I don't think it's very good intel. I think one of the problems is that they get a lot of information out of Russia, which really corresponds to their own ideas about the country, doesn't really tell them very much about the actual situation in the country, and certainly doesn't tell them very much about how the country, Russia, is capable of responding, and responding very quickly when it faces these kind of challenges. Can I just say, I mean, there was an absolutely fascinating demolition of the Kagan-Nuland articles that have appeared by Patrick Armstrong, who's a very, very astute Russia watcher, a former Canadian diplomat. And he made exactly that point, that these people work from an extraordinary lack of understanding of what Russia is really like. So the result is they completely underestimate it. They assume it's a house of cards. They assume that it will sit, you know, like, you know, the rabbit caught in the headlights of the coming car, and, you know, they can do all these various moves, and that the Russians won't somehow react, and then, you know, it'll all fold like a house of cards. And of course, it doesn't actually work like that, because Russia isn't that kind of country anymore. It was maybe at, you know, the late 90s and the early 2000s, but it isn't like that now.
Let me ask you real quick before we end the video about Navalny. What do you make of what's going on with Navalny? The latest news is that he's being moved to a prison hospital. They say the doctors, this is the news that I'm getting, the doctors say that he's in a stable condition. People that support Navalny say that he's not. What do you make of what's going on there? Do you have anything that you could further add to this situation?
No, I can't add anything to the situation. I mean, this is clearly, again, an information war. But I mean, I can't imagine that the Russian authorities would not be very careful to make sure that Navalny, you know, isn't going to be given whatever treatment he needs.
What if?
It's not in their interest that he shouldn't be.
What if?
But what if? All right, what if? I mean, there have been opinion polls about him in Russia, and they show that people are not very sympathetic to him there. Radio Liberty sent a team of people to the town where he's actually, this prison is, and they were so taken aback by how strong popular reaction to him was that, you know, they backed away. There's a good article about this by Paul Robinson, by the way, who's a Canadian academic who also follows the situation with Navalny very closely. So I don't think, actually, that there is much sympathy or very much interest about him in Russia, generally. I think this is something, again, which many people in the West don't really understand. To them, he is a person of huge importance. To Russians, he is not. And I have to say something else. He is somebody who does grandstand an awful lot. And I think in terms of these latest things that have been pouring out about his bad state of health and all of that, I think an awful lot of people in Russia just don't believe it, because he's said similar things in the past. I don't know what the truth is. I've no way of finding out because, as I said, I don't have his medical tests. But I don't think the Russian authorities will want to see him become seriously ill. But even if he does, I think most Russians will just shrug their shoulders. And that's the reality about it.
How would you compare something happening to Navalny with, say, what happened to, I don't know if you remember, Nemtsov? I think that was 2000, Boris Nemtsov in 2015, was it? I mean, I know they're not directly, I know it's not comparing apples with apples, but I remember the protests were large and it did put the government under significant amount of pressure. Do you see any parallels there if we're going down this what-if path,
No, well, I mean, I'd say straight away. I mean, Nemtsov was a person who had had a major political role in Russia. He'd been in the 1990s a prominent figure within Boris Yeltsin's government. There'd been a time when some people had expected him to become Russia's president. A lot of people knew him. Far more people knew about him and took him far more seriously than they did Navalny. And of course, there was the extraordinary way in which he was killed, which has happened in full view on a bridge in Moscow. It was all very shocking. And that was a galvanizing event. So we're talking about somebody who had been a major figure, who'd held political and elected office. Remember, Navalny has never held political or elected office in Russia. He's never been somebody that, has been, Navalny has never been somebody who's ever been thought of in Russia as a major political figure in the way that Nemtsov was. So I think it's different. The other thing to say about Nemtsov, and I think this is a major difference, is of course that the geopolitical environment is different, is so profoundly different now. I mean, when Nemtsov was killed, relations between Russia and the West were nowhere near as bad as they are now. And Russians didn't feel anything like the kind of pressure that they do today. So that has caused a kind of hardening of Russian society and greater skepticism, far greater skepticism towards figures like Navalny or indeed even Nemtsov. And one of the things people don't appreciate, perhaps, is that the various liberal parties in Russia, which never polled very much anyway, seem to be in a state of advanced disintegration now. Their polling figures, which were always, you know, in the low digits, have, if anything, bombed even more. So I really just don't think this is the big event that some people think it is. I don't think the protests on Wednesday, if they take place, which I presume they will be very big, or at least anywhere near as big as some people in the West anticipate. And I think, as I said, that the Russians will be very careful to make sure that Navalny himself isn't in any real, you know, the thing that people fear will actually happen. So I think that they have, again, probably game-planned this very carefully.
Okay. We'll leave it there. Guys, I'll drop a 10% coupon. Use Real News at checkout. 10% off all merchandise at the Duran Shop. Take care.